It is my real honor today to be joined by Alex Gorsky, the chairman and CEO of Johnson & Johnson, Dr. Mark McClellan, director of the Duke-Margolis Center for Health Policy at Duke University, and former commissioner of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, and Dr. Susan David, an award-winning Harvard Medical School psychologist and author of the best-selling book, Emotional Agility. Mark will be joining our panel a bit later, so we'll start with Alex and Susan. First of all, Alex and Susan, thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, John, for having us. Susan, let me
start with you. Communities across the country are facing incredibly important questions around racial justice, as well as challenges related to the pandemic. How can your process around emotional agility come into play during this difficult time?
Well, this is a really important question. Earlier, we raised this issue of resilience and of business resilience. But of course, no business is resilient without individuals, leaders, and employees who are resilient. And so emotional agility is this critical set of skills that help us to deal with the world as it is, not as we wish it to be, but as it is right now, so that we can create the change that we need. So I think there's some key skills that are critical when we think about the pandemic, but also the incredibly important conversations that we've been having of late that are long overdue. And these are this, that when human beings are faced with complexity and challenge, often what we do is we default down to rigid thinking. We become very siloed, we become very us and them, and we become stuck in our difficult thoughts and emotions. So some core skills become important in order to be agile. The first is that our emotions evolved to help us to adapt to threat. And if there was ever a time when people were experiencing threat, it's in the shadow of uncertainty, illness, death, and injustice. So the first thing that I would say is as a business owner, if you are experiencing frustration, anger, grief, disappointment, anxiety, loneliness, whatever emotion you are experiencing right now, it is normal. It's your body's way of adapting and gathering resources for yourself. The second thing that I would say is we tend not to have strong emotions about things that we don't care about. So if you're feeling angry right now, your anger might signpost that you value equity and fairness, and it is leading you to look at your business and your life and say, how can I take active steps in the service of that value? If you are feeling lonely, that might be a signpost that you value connection, whether it's with your employees or with your wider community, and you don't have enough of it. So face into the difficult experience. We are not in the business of denial or avoidance. We are in the business of facing into experience with compassion and curiosity, so that we can move forward, even if that's uncomfortable, towards the values and creating a life that we want to create and a world that we want to live in and raise our families in. And I think these are some core questions that the coronavirus and the events of the past couple of weeks and months, they've really delivered a gut punch to us as human beings. And I think this is an invitation for all of us to be asking the question, who do I want to be right now? How can I bring myself forward so that I am living into being the parent, the business owner, the life individual, and the community that I want to start creating?
Thank you, Susan. Those are some very helpful thoughts, really much appreciated. Alex, let's talk just a bit about Johnson & Johnson. You lead a company, one of the great companies in the world, 130,000 employees, many of whom are on the front lines fighting against COVID-19. How have you helped guide your employees when it comes to feeling safe during this health crisis, especially those who have to go to the office or a lab really on the front lines? And has that evolved over time as the crisis has unfolded?
Yeah, John, look, like you, when we started in these industries probably 30 or 35 years ago, whoever would have thought that we would be in roles like these when we're facing arguably one of the most serious public health challenges the world has ever faced, one of the most significant economic crises in our history, and then overlay that with, again, these other issues of racism and injustice all simultaneously. it can be a bit overwhelming. And I think in our case, I think we're all humans. So the first thing we need to do is admit that we're vulnerable, that we were probably never fully prepared for something like this, but we are going to do our absolute very best to help to ensure that we can navigate our way through. And look, in our case, it started with number one, it was health and safety. You know, it's the world's largest healthcare company, filled with literally thousands of people who are experts in the fields of immunology, oncology, cardiovascular, surgery, and other areas, making sure that we quickly prioritized and established clear guidelines and protocols around the safety of our employees was more important than ever. And that started by, in many cases, closing our facilities, allowing people to work from home, giving them a sense of security and safety, and knowing that we were going to continue to support them going forward regarding their jobs and what kind of support they could expect from us, to ensure that they would have time to deal with the issues that they might have with their families. And so many of our employees were finding themselves in a situation of not only were they stressed about their business or their function at work, but how are they going to mentor their children while they're Zooming and taking calculus that maybe they haven't taken for 30 years. And balancing all that early on was clearly mission number one. Two, it's also important to remember that while we've got about 130,000 employees, that and about 30 to 40,000 of those employees are still working every day. They're not Zooming. They're going into our factories, our plants and facilities to make sure that people can still get the medicines and the doctors can get the instruments that they need. They're still going in conducting clinical trials on the next round of medications. So making sure that was in place. And I think the other key part for us is making sure that people also felt part of something bigger than themselves and a purpose. And clearly, very early on when we made announcements that we were going to be searching our entire library of medicines to try to develop a therapeutic, a medicine that could make a difference on patients infected by the COVID-19 virus, when we were able to announce that we were in fact pivoting and putting all of our available resources and efforts behind a vaccine and its development, which hopefully we'll get a chance to talk about later. I think also, frankly, was very inspiring to know that it wasn't just a few of us, but in fact, all of those employees could in fact make a difference literally for billions of people around the world. And so by ensuring their safety, making sure at the same time that they were part of something truly important for the world, we think were some of the critical steps to take through this.
Well, we are in fact gonna get to the vaccine, but before we do, I'm gonna shift to Susan, but I'm looking forward to getting the vaccine because we're all rooting for you, as I know all 130,000 of your employees are as well, and working very hard, and we appreciate it. Susan, you've said that often as people go through difficult situations, it leads us all to reassess how we live. What can all of us, and especially for the small business owners joining us today, take away from these last few months as we all reassess?
Well, I think wisdom at its core is about recognizing that life is simultaneously beautiful and it's fragile. That we are young until we are not, that the only certainty is uncertainty. And I think when as business owners, we move away from trying to find certainty and we instead breathe into the uncertainty, into that dialectic, it becomes far more possible to reassess and to think about, you know, who do we want to be in the context that we are facing? So I'll give you an example of what I mean by growth that can come through difficulty. We know, for instance, at an individual level that when people go through tough experiences, for instance, cancer, they can have that tough experience and simultaneously they can look back at the experience and say, gee, you know, I reassessed who I was. I've grown as a person. I've reconnected with my strengths. I've recognized some of the things that I have found to be really important previously are no longer important. And I think really what's happened is there is a massive pause that's been put on the world in many ways. And in that pause, we have opportunity. You know, to use the beautiful, wonderful, and I think probably extraordinarily powerful sentiment of Viktor Frankl. Viktor Frankl survived the Nazi death camps. And he described this profoundly powerful idea that between stimulus and response, there is a space. And in that space is our power to choose. And it's in that choice that lies our growth and freedom. Now, often there is no space between stimulus and response. We go through our day, we're so busy, we go on vacation, we come back, we're exhausted. We've got all of our systems and processes in the organization, and we just almost on autopilot are moving forward. But we're not actually in any space of wisdom. We're not in the space of the pause and saying, who do we want to be? What was I doing that might not have been working? Or what was I doing that might not reflect who I want to be? So I think for all of us, there is this invitation to step into the pause. And we don't need to do it in a massive way. Sometimes we can just be doing it in a small way, thinking about, you know, what are ways that I've been running my business, demands that I've been placing on people that, you know, are meeting, but don't allow people to do deep work. What are some systemic injustices that I sew into my hiring processes or my engagement and culture or, you know, payment processes that actually are not who I want to be as an organization? So I would really encourage, I think, for all of us who are small business owners, and I am one of them, you know, despite my work at Harvard, I, you know, run a business. And I think for all of us, this is the opportunity for us to say, individually, are there ways that I am being that don't reflect who I want to be? Are there ways that I'm being that don't reflect my intention in terms of the way I'm parenting or coming to my relationships? Are there ways that I'm leading that don't reflect who I want to be? And then are there systemic bureaucratic processes in the organization that we can pause and that we can look at and say, how can we do things differently, wiser, or with greater levels of growth? And I think, you know, Alex highlighted something that's really critical. We can have the greatest strategy on earth, but unless we are connecting with the hearts and minds and voices of the people that we work with, that strategy can be meaningless. And so this is a time for all of us where, as a leader, especially a leader of a small business, we don't and we simply cannot have all the answers. The only certainty, again, is uncertainty. But I think if we step back into the pause and we focus on listening more and focus on asking our staff questions like, you know, I don't have all the answers, but what we can do is choose who we want to be in the situation. How do we want to team together? What is the vision that we are moving towards? Who do we want to be as an organization? These are really important questions that I think can help us to really grow and develop and be sustainable, even in the midst of the struggle, and to really create an organization and a business that feels thoughtful and intentional, rather than just it's the way we've always been doing it. And I think it's a really powerful moment for all of us.
I promised we'd get to the vaccine, so let's get to a topic that I know is near and dear to all of our hearts. Johnson & Johnson has identified a lead candidate. What is the state of the vaccine development? I saw, I think Paul Stoffels was on CNBC earlier today. I was watching before this panel, and he talked a bit about the progress you're making. Maybe you can just talk about the progress you're making, some of the complexities that you're wrestling with as you're trying to navigate through this, you know, quite compressed time frame.
Sure. Well, you know, let me start by just, you know, giving recognition and a huge thanks to not only Dr. Paul Stoffels, but the thousands of scientists, researchers, and engineers that have literally been working 24/7 on this since we were, you know, first made aware of the virus and the potential implications late last year and early this year. And you know, what took place, you know, very early on is, and this is a category that we've been invested in for more than 10 years. We've worked with vaccines in areas such as Ebola, such as HIV, SARS, and MERS. In fact, the vaccine platform that we're currently developing has been utilized in more than 65,000 patients in places like the Republic of Congo, with both patients old and young, which gives us significant confidence in the fundamental safety and efficacy of the approach. But once our scientists were able to get the genetic code of the virus very early on, They quickly synthesized that, and then working in a partnership with Deaconess and in other facilities, came up with an approach whereby we would take a carrier virus, so think of it as a common cold virus, where if it was a piece of string, we snipped out a very important piece of it responsible for replication, and we inserted an actual segment of the virus. And what this then gives us the ability is to introduce this to a person so that your body is basically tricked into thinking it's a cold virus, but in fact, it then recognizes that it could be the coronavirus and the spike protein and quickly begins producing something called neutralizing antibodies. And so our scientists begin testing that theory in animal models. And we run that through a number of different tests. And as you heard in the announcement today, we're now prepared to move to a stage where we would begin testing in humans, as soon as the latter weeks of July. And, you know, what's critical here is that we have to produce a vaccine that's safe. And again, we think based upon the experience that we have in this carrier, that will build a lot of data. We still need a lot more testing. We certainly have to build one that's effective, and the early data out of preclinical or animal models is encouraging, but we need to find out how that translates into humans. Then the third critical element for a vaccine is you need to produce it at scale. And fortunately, again, due to more than a decade of investing, we've got a technology that allows us to produce literally hundreds of millions of doses of vaccine in a relatively short period of time. But with John, what I would tell you again is this is something that normally takes 5 or 7 years. To do this in 5 or 7 months, to ensure we're not compromising safety or efficacy or scalability is a Herculean task, to say the least. This is an Apollo moonshot, but we're working in a very collaborative way with the FDA, with BARDA, which is the vaccine division within our government, with the CDC, NIH, with similar agencies in Europe and around the world. Because frankly, why some would say, well, how could we do that in such a short period of time? We look at it the opposite way and say, how could we not try to do that in a shorter period of time, given how many lives we've already lost and how many lives we could lose if we're not able to achieve this kind of success? It won't be a panacea. A vaccine will need to be used with therapeutics, with medicines. It'll need to be used with protocols. There's still so much work that needs to be done, but I'm incredibly proud of the progress that we're making. And we are 190% committed to doing everything we can to make that possible.
Well, it's the ultimate public-private partnership in my view, and we commend you for all the effort you're making on behalf of the country, really, and the world. And so, you know, we can't thank you enough. Let me bring in Dr. Mark McClellan, who I think has now joined us. Thank you for coming, Mark. We appreciate the time. So you've been advising policymakers and business leaders around the country on how to safely reopen, and you've outlined, I believe, a 4-phase reopening plan. How do you think business leaders, particularly those running small businesses, which is really the reason for us getting together today, should be thinking about that phase reopening?
Well, we're getting there. So the key elements of reopening include things like making sure healthcare systems aren't under stress. And as Alex was saying earlier, fortunately, in most parts of the country, we closed down early enough to prevent that kind of big surge like we saw in New York and New Jersey and some other urban areas. So most of these health systems have excess capacity now. Second important element of reopening safely is access to testing. And that's improving. It's uneven around the country, but it's getting better in most places. People who have symptoms that could be COVID-19 should get tested, should take steps for isolation. And as businesses, especially small businesses, reopen, you know, you don't want to have to reclose. So it's important to be aware of the testing resources in your area, and it's important to take advantage of some of the protocols that can help use them. Third key element is the ability to manage any outbreaks that do occur. So that's contact tracing, and states and local governments are setting up programs to do that. for small businesses, there are now a lot of resources available if you haven't already heard about them from your business association or other colleagues that can provide some guidance on things to think about how as you reopen. And states are doing it a little bit differently from state to state in terms of how quickly they're going forward with reopening and how, and that's based in part on the situation in each local community. There are typically state guidances available specific to businesses. And it's worth spending a little bit of time and effort looking at those. I think the main things to keep in mind are having some distancing steps set up in your business, both to reduce the likelihood of potential transmission between people who work at the company as well as with customers, and there are contactless ways to do that, recommendations about spacing tables or aisles or things like that. And it's also really important to have some clear guidance for your employees so that they know that they shouldn't come in if they've got COVID-19 symptoms, and they know that there are places to get tests, free tests in their area. And generally those can be done pretty quickly within a day or so. And if they do have test positive for COVID-19, it doesn't necessarily mean you need to shut down your business for 2 weeks. There are though some specific steps around deep cleaning and the like that are important as well. So a lot of guidance out there now, and it is important to pay attention to all this because, you know, we're not past the pandemic yet. In many areas of the country, especially those that had the low case rates to begin with, the rates of cases are actually going up. Hospital occupancy is, again, it's not generally at threat levels, but it is increasing. And that's going to be a challenge over time if we aren't careful about reopening cautiously and following these kinds of steps.
Alex, I just want to ask you about the healthcare industry, because you talked about the BRT, which is kind of cross industries. But like finance and banking, healthcare is quite a competitive industry. But my observation is that you, as an industry, have really come together in quite an important way here to work on solutions more broadly. I'm just interested in your perspective on that.
Sure, John. Yeah, as I mentioned earlier, I'm really proud of the way the industry has rallied and realized that this isn't competition between company A, B, or C, but it's competition against the virus. How do we rally all of our capabilities, our resources, in a way that ultimately saves lives and makes a difference? And I'm very proud of what the industry is doing. And frankly, we wouldn't be in the position that we're in today. We are seeing dozens and dozens of new vaccine candidates with not only traditional platforms, protein platforms, but things with RNA, DNA, mRNA, vector approaches, as we're talking about. None of this would have been possible without the billions of dollars of research that's been invested over the past several decades. And to imagine that we can actually take a piece of a DNA sequence, insert it into a virus that we then, can actually put into a body to be replicate that produces neutralizing antibodies in the kind of time frame that we're talking about is quite remarkable. And so I'm very proud. However, at the same time, while the science and the biology has incredible promise, we've got to make sure that there's access, not only to patients in the United States, but patients in every zip code in the United States. What we've got to do is help solve some of the disparities, not widen them even further. We've got to make sure that we have vaccines available around the world, in developed countries and developing countries. We've got to make sure that it's done at an affordable price. We were very happy that, and we thought it was important for a company like us to step up and say we would do this on a not-for-profit basis to ensure that, again, around the world, people could get access. And again, I think those are the kind of things that are critical for the industry to do, at this particular time. But I think the other major change coming of all this that not only impacts the pharmaceutical industry, but all of us, is the appreciation and understanding of strong and vibrant public healthcare systems. And public healthcare systems aren't created overnight. We need to invest in them over decades. We need to make sure that we're making those efforts proactively ahead of time whether it's in ventilators, whether it's in storing medicines, whether it's in making sure we've got the kind of ICU and CCU beds, whether we're investing in vaccines for the future. It takes a comprehensive approach, because I think one thing that we're certainly learning is that we don't have healthcare security, we don't have national security, we don't have economic security, we don't have societal security if we don't have public healthcare security. And I think coming out of this, that's got to be a key lesson that we learn and take forward.
Mark, let me ask you, you were the former commissioner of the FDA, an administrator of the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services. How do you think the COVID-19 crisis has changed the way Washington confronts healthcare challenges in the future?
Well, we know we've got work to do ahead. So there have been all kinds of responses from the agencies that I used to work with. I've been very proud to see what FDA has been able to do to be a partner in that kind of acceleration of innovation, not just for vaccines, but for therapeutics for COVID-19. And there also are some new, more rapid diagnostics coming along that'll be easier to use out in the community and hopefully can also give more accurate results. So all of that is taking place. And you're seeing, like Alex said, more of a partnership approach in solving these big problems in a timely way. And I think the way that we do medical research is going to be changed forever with this notion of, we can work on several things at the same time. We can do the preclinical studies. We can get clinical trials set up in more places so they can go more quickly. We can think about manufacturing ahead of time with more secure supply chains. So all of that's, I think, here to stay, and FDA and the government is going to be a big part of hopefully getting that right for the future. And on the healthcare side, we've seen COVID-19's exposed the gaps. So we had disparities by race and by socioeconomic status before. Those are really clear, unfortunately, in how the pandemic has impacted individuals and communities. And I think especially for businesses that are trying to help people get back to work and trying to rebuild stronger communities along the lines you've already talked about, healthcare is a really important part of that. We need to get our healthcare systems reopened, but we need resilient healthcare systems. It's going to be different. Hopefully in the future, we'll see more care that's delivered via telemedicine that people can get at home, that's easier for workers to get their healthcare needs met in a way that doesn't disrupt their day and their work so much. And some of the technologies that we're adopting now can help with that. I just had a meeting with the current leader of CMS today, where we talked about changes in the way that Medicare is going to pay and changes in the way that many private insurers are paying for employers to really help them focus on keeping people well in the community. And that's an area where we're going to need a partnership, including with the small businesses, to make healthcare work in a way that does a better job of addressing disparities, that emphasizes prevention and community-based care more, and that can be a really important part of building stronger communities.
Thanks to everyone for joining us this evening, and especially to our panelists for sharing their insights with all of us.